Senator Cornyn and Senator Cruz, but we really just wanted to show you this awesome new video screen. So, but we are, we work so closely with them. You know, to appreciate the future of entrepreneurship, we really, like I mentioned, wanted to bring in some of our state's most well-known and eminent entrepreneurs, Dr. James Leininger, Red McCombs, Jim Henry, and moderating the conversation, and I think Evan representing the next generation of great entrepreneurs is Evan Baer. I'm going to just say a couple things about and introduce each panelist since I know them all very well, and then turn it over to Evan and for each of these gentlemen to tell their stories. First, and let me say too, I don't want to go through a litany of all the accomplishments because they're a lot, and all of the great businesses that have been started and sold, and all the amazing, you know, employment opportunities that these men have put forward. You can read that in their bios, but I just want to give you a little bit of a flavor of these gentlemen. Dr. Jim Leininger, of course, everyone knows, was the founder of TPPF, one of the most successful businessmen in our generation in the medical device industry, and he and his wife in a one-bedroom apartment many years ago invented a hospital bed, and he was an ER doctor at the time, serving at the base in San Antonio. But more than that, what Dr. Jim really embodies is the love for this state and this country and the willingness to invest and give it all back. The first time I met Dr. Jim was many years ago. I was actually working for Governor Perry at the time, and I was in a meeting with him on behalf of Governor Perry, and I remember thinking, I'd heard so much about Dr. Jim Leininger, and I'd never met him before. So I sort of expected, and the media had a heyday with him because he was such a big school choice fan, that I was not expecting the gentleman that I ended up meeting. And so I walked in and sat down, and this very nice man was sitting right next to me, but he was wearing a sports jacket from Walmart, and had a Timex watch on, and I actually had seen him pull up in the parking lot, and he was driving a 1985 Suburban, and I saw him get out, and we went around the room, and everyone introduced themselves, and it got to him, and he said, well, I'm Jim Leininger. And I almost fell out of my seat, because that is not what I was expecting, but what that day illustrated for me, and what I have learned all these many years later, is the goodness and the humbleness and the down-to-earth and the true love of his God and his family above all else are just such an example for all of us. Dr. Jim, thank you for being with us here today. It's an honor. And a couple rows down, Jim Henry. Again, you can read about one of the great oilmen of Texas history. At an age where most men would be enjoying a quiet retirement, Jim, he is still moving forward, maximizing his amazing potential, not only in his business world and losing none of his entrepreneurial zeal, but while he's building one of the great oil companies in Texas and continues to do so, he's skydiving, he's bungee jumping in New Zealand, he's rappelling off of tall buildings with the Boy Scouts. I think one time, it's not in my notes here, Jim, but I remember I came to Midland to have lunch with you, and I think you had just played tennis with
Roger Federer
at the age of almost 80 at the time, and I think he even kept up with him. Jim is the kind of man who made Texas the great state that it is, and more important, I think, the kind of man and leader that is laying the foundation for our Texas future. Please help me welcome the great Jim Henry to the stage. And last but never least, Red McCombs, the legendary Red McCombs, the man whose name, of course, graces the McCombs School of Business at the little school just down the road, and our wonderful, of course, Red McCombs Event Center on the sixth floor of this building. If you want a modern-day Texas entrepreneurial success tale, the McCombs story is it. He was seemingly born with every quality of the classic American success story: bold, quick, savvy, and a smart risk taker who seized the Texas dream with both hands at an early age and never let go. His story begins small, of course, selling cars in Corpus Christi, and swiftly grew huge under the vision of a man who saw no limit to the dream, and dreaming as wide and as expansive as Texas. One of my favorite Red McCombs stories, and there are a lot of them, I've gotten to know him very well over the last many years, and he's such an inspiration to me, but I love to tell people, I went in to talk to him about the building, and he loved the idea of the building. I mentioned this earlier for those of you that were there, that he said, Brooke, this building is gonna change everything for you and for Texas, and I said, I agree with that, and that's why you should invest, and he said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you half what you're asking for. And I said, he's negotiating with me. The great Red McCombs is negotiating with me. And I thought, you know, this is the epitome of the one of the greatest entrepreneurial success stories in America. And I hope he tells a little bit about his time owning the Minnesota Vikings and his time when he began Clear Channel, helped begin Clear Channel Communications, and all of the just amazing stories he's been involved with. I think you'll really enjoy it. And of course, Evan Baer at the end, one of our next generation of great entrepreneurs, founded Outbox, which was a direct counter to the U.S. Postal Service, and has done many other things, as I think started multiple businesses at this point, graduate of Princeton and of Harvard, and is really, really an extraordinary mind, and we're so grateful to have him here as well. So please help me welcome our distinguished panel.
Well, thank you, Brooke, and thank you, Wendy, and just hats off to the amazing staff and board and donors and supporters of TPPF. This is just an extraordinary facility, and it's a real honor to me to get to sit before some legends of Texas and on this really august day of launching the new facility. I'm lucky in that I get to office just a few blocks from here. It was my co-founder, Will Davis, who's in the back, who hails from Lubbock, that about 5 years ago when we were classmates at, yeah, that's a gun as a reference, shoot him. I'm still learning these things. He says, I've got this crazy idea, we should try to take over the Postal Service. And that was just crazy enough to be interesting to me. And then we had this challenge of, my wife and I had planned to move back to California. Will was dead set on moving to Texas. And it took a little convincing my wife, who's originally from Manhattan but has some Texas roots, to persuade her and the rest of our crew that we should come to Texas. And so that move was about 5 years ago, and so we get to live in Austin and build companies here. And early on, we were building a business that was taking a direct offensive at the federal government, looking at the incompetence of the United States Postal Service and trying to build a great technology solution that helps American citizens have an alternative. It was Will's idea to actually put a come and take it flag up in our office, and it just felt amazingly Texan. But I have to say, as I've gotten to know more of Austin, I'm starting to appreciate the idea that it's a blueberry in the tomato soup. You know, I spend a lot of time with entrepreneurs who are in their 20s and 30s, men and women who've made, you know, millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars building their businesses in Texas, who have no idea what TPPF does. They have no idea what's happening in the state. For the most part, they vote straight party tickets for Democrats, and they just assume that the economic conditions that enable them to build their business are going to be things that continue to last. And this is a panel of three amazing men, and TPF is an organization that understands that that's not something we should take for granted. So I am so excited that just a few blocks away from our headquarters, we get to have this space, and hopefully Brooke will have us back and we can convince more of these left-leaning tech entrepreneurs to come take some of these ideas seriously. Well, we're going to get started just starting with Dr. Jim at the end of the line. We're going to take a few minutes. We'd love to just hear some of your story, particularly what got you interested early on in taking on sometimes these controversial positions of defending limited governments and free markets. Tell us a bit about that story.
Well, the first thing that happened to get me involved politically was, I guess the first thing was Ronald Reagan. I wrote him a small check. And other than that, I voted in presidential elections, and that was about it. But we started a small company when I was running the three Baptist Hospital emergency rooms, and it, I made every mistake you would expect a doctor to make, and we were near bankruptcy for about almost nine and a half years, basically, and finally it began to turn around, and our sales were doubling every year. We finally had a product that people liked, and it wasn't too difficult for the nurses or the emergency room or the ICU crews. And so we were looking at going public, and our insurance, liability insurance company, called us up and said they were going to cancel our insurance. And I said, well, you know, we're going public here in 6 months and probably going to need to have liability insurance. So why are you canceling our insurance? We had never been sued. And they said, well, you're in the medical business. That's a high-risk business. And I said, well, yeah, but we've been in the medical business for 10 years. We've never been sued. So why are we being canceled? They said, well, we're just pulling out of Texas, and we're not doing anything in medical at all. And I just couldn't understand what was going on. Nobody would, just give me this straight scoop here. And so I was confused for about a year, and they did cancel us, and we finally got, some other company, and then we had in 86, they had Black Friday or whatever it was, and market crashed, and we couldn't go public anyway. And I'm still confused about it. I don't even know why our insurance got canceled. And then I went to a fundraiser for Tom Phillips when he was first running for the Supreme Court, and they had his Justice for Sale in Texas tape playing, the 60 Minutes tape. And I sat that there and watched that, and I said, now I understand. And I had asked lawyers, I had asked everybody, nobody gave me the deal, a small handful of trial lawyers owned the Supreme Court. So I just, I decided right then and there I was going to get involved. I was just offended that, people would do that and could do that in a state as great as Texas. So I got involved with all kinds of Supreme Court races, and before long we had changed out that entire court. And then I really became passionate about school choice, and fought that fight for about 20 years and lost. Basically, the education bureaucracy has about 800,000 employees in Texas, and they're way bigger than I was. So they, when they flex their muscles, every legislator kind of got a little weak in the knees, it seemed like back then. So. Hopefully this year we've got a great chance to pass something to allow kids that are trapped in failing and unsafe schools to go to a school that they want to go to and that they think is best for them.
But so some people encounter a problem with their business and they decide to read a book or, write a letter. What caused you to just be so zealous and so commit so much time and resources to these causes?
Just
to the causes. You weren't nearly trying to say, I need to fix this problem for my business. You were devoting your life in many ways to these ideas. Tell us more about that.
Well, part of it was we did in 1988, we went public. And, there's so many amazing business stories. But in 86, I think there's a lot of people here who remember this. In 1986, the long-term capital gains was going away. And so everybody was trying to sell their business. And that was a problem because, our business was doing great, but everybody else was trying to recapitalize or sell their business or somehow take that long-term capital gain while it was still there and before it went away. So we tried to find a buyer, couldn't find anybody willing to pay anywhere near what we thought it was worth. So we went to Merrill Lynch and borrowed $50 million, and just offered everybody who had been in the company, who had stock in the company, to buy back their shares. And when we first started in 1976, the minimum investment to buy stock was $20,000. So we left it as like $1 a share, and we left it at that price for the next 9 years because we weren't doing very good. And finally it started to take off. So we bought back people's shares, that people that had invested $20,000 got $1 million for their stock. Hmm. So needless to say, it was fully signed up for the, and as it turned out, the IRS rules were that I was the only one that couldn't sell their stock because I was the majority shareholder. So all of a sudden, our parking lot has all these new pickup trucks in it, and I'm still driving my old Suburban. And I thought, I was a little bit perturbed about that. But then the business kept doing great, and 2 years later, we went public, and I owned like 98% of the stock. That was really good. So we went public, and so all this to say, I was financially in really good shape at that point. And so, you know, I was very passionate about school choice and about tort reform. And, you know, thankfully, I don't know if Dick Weekly's here. I saw him earlier, but, man, Dick Weekly took over tort reform and never looked back and did a phenomenal job. And we're still struggling with school choice. I mean, it's the right thing for the kids. Two entire generations have gone through K through 12 while we've been trying to do it, and the schools today are as bad or worse as they were 26 years ago. So that's the number one thing we've got to fix in Texas.
Thank you. Well, Red, tell us a little bit about your journey.
I was born in 1927, so that I'm about to be 88 years old. My grandparents were both, on both sides of the family, were sharecroppers out in dry land in West Texas, which is not a very, very interesting or enterprising way to live. My daddy walked off of the farm with a third grade education when he was 19 years old and persuaded the Ford dealer in our little town of Spur, Texas, out in Dickens County, had persuaded him to let him become a mechanic. And so he gave him free meals and a dirt floor in his garage and about 9 technical manuals. And although my dad only did to the third grade in school, he was a very bright man and an avid, avid reader. So he became very, very, very excelling in his field, and he was totally pleased and satisfied to serve in that capacity, because in those days there weren't too many people that could fix the machines. The machines were not very well made, and there was a great need, and there was a great respect for someone who did what my father did. So although we had very modest monetary circumstances, we had a very, very good life. I have 3 sibs, and the 4 of us lived in very, very fine circumstances. But being born in 1927, and being one that is always very observant about what's happening around me, I was very much aware of the Depression. Very much aware of the people moving west to California, and there are a lot of experiences there. But to me personally, I always hustled for use of time. And I convinced myself at a very early age that the greatest gift of all was the gift of life, and all of us were created totally equal, because God gives us 24 hours a day. Nobody gets any more, nobody gets any less. And I was very concerned that I'd do the most that I could get done in that 24 hours. I drove my mother about half crazy because she was trying to take care of my 3 younger sibs and couldn't understand why I was never at home. But I liked doing more than one thing at a time from the time I can remember. One was because it was not boring to be doing several things, and secondly, you had added revenue. I never was money hungry, but I never was opposed to carrying around a little either. I was entrepreneurial before I heard the word. I didn't know what it was, but that was what I was. There was no one in my family tree that had ever been in any kind of business, so it really was kind of unusual that I would be so fascinated as I was by the field of business. One of the things that I always want to be wherever I am is I want to be in a leadership role. And I work very hard to get into leadership roles. I'll take the worst assignment that you got if you give me a shot, and I'll do it better than the guy next to me. And it's pretty simple. I did develop early on a real simple credo, and that was I expect to win. I don't like people telling me, well, I'm different. I like to win. Well, who doesn't like to win? You know, I'd like to look like Clark Gable, too, but that's not going to happen. But I expect to win, and I know how to win, and most of the time I do win. But when I lose, I don't look back. I don't stay in things that don't work. And if they don't work, I don't give it that old last try and my last breath, and I'm going down with the ship. I've sold a lot of businesses, small and large, that I couldn't do very well, that other people did very well. And I'm proud of them, glad they did. I think the entrepreneurs are the people that made it a better quality of life for everyone who ever lived. They're the ones that were concerned about what in even ancient times, what was over the mountain, how do you get there, what are they doing, and create a better life for those around them. So I think the entrepreneur's never been quite understood. When I look today and I see the great things happening in the world, most of it is driven by entrepreneurs. I got a letter yesterday, being a very minor shareholder in Steven Schwartzman's programs. And when you read that six-page report to the shareholders, and if you aren't proud to be the fact that you live in a country where you can participate and you can get involved, then shame on you. So education is the answer. It's the ticket. I think everyone figures that out pretty early, and educators don't like very often when I'm like on an educators panel, I'll say education. I didn't really go to school for an education. I went to school for a ticket. I got the ticket. It worked, and we're still working on it. So I feel very, very excited about being able to live the life of an entrepreneur. And I'm even more excited that I have children and grandchildren now in my various businesses, and we will continue to try to do things better. One thing that I will say, a lot of students come to me and say, you know, what should I do? Well, the first thing, do better than what you're doing. Well, I don't like what I'm doing. Well, you're going to have to do what you're doing until you get something better. So do better at what you're doing. Do better at what you're doing, and you'll be noticed. And if your boss doesn't notice you, a competitor will, or a vendor will, and you're going to be noticed. It never fails, and it won't fail. So that's really my life. Really would sound like it's very complicated. It's very simple. Just get up, do more than you did yesterday. And thank God that you have another day to do it. I never have seen a guy die from hard work yet. I understand bureaucracy, and I hate it. It takes away from the lifestyle of all of us. It's a poison, but we have it everywhere. And if you have just a little, you're fortunate. Everything has got a bureaucracy tied to it. I understand the EPA. I've been on a project in Colorado for 28 years, a project that the Forest Service asked me to do, and then the Enviros decided I shouldn't do it. So 28 years, still fighting the Enviros. And the only reason I'm doing it is because I'm just not going to let them win. and I will win. So I don't think that anything that I've done is real unusual. I don't think anything I've done is all that important. But if you put together everything I've done, it gets to be a pretty nice pile. Thank you.
Jim, I'm not going to let Brooke's comment go by. Just before you dive into your story, tell us about playing Federer in tennis. Did she make this up, or did it really happen?
It really happened. The way you get to do something like that is you let Goldman Sachs or one of the others manage your money for you.
Okay.
And so there was about 20 of us in line waiting to hit with Federer, and there's all these young guys, college students, about 6'2", 6'3", and ex-tennis players, and then there was me, 80 years old, there. And I think I won the crowd over because Federer would hit it right directly to me perfectly. He's quite a gentleman. He's so nice. And then I'd hit it back, and I was even grunting. I was hitting it so hard. And then they went like this. Then I wasn't getting by him, so I lobbed over him. And the crowd went, oh, because it went out. So, but it was so much fun playing against a gentleman like Federer. Hmm. He was really great.
Tell us more about your journey.
Okay. First, I would like to say this is a Henry Resources journey, and I've got with me my wife, Paula Henry, right there, and Rick Fletcher, our chief counsel, who's now on the board of TPPF. So. We want to not only give our money, but give our time.
Wait, I see. This is your daughter here. Is your wife? Oh, okay. Okay.
We've been married for 50 years. So she was. She's 9 years younger than I am. So that's, so she's very young. So, so let me tell you about our company. First, let me say it's nice to see all of y'all here. Nice to see everyone from Midland and Todd and I. Everybody and Ernie and a lot of people here that have helped me reach the decision to help support TPPF. So, and everybody up there too. Let me tell you about our story. First, you need to know that we really attempt to be a Christian company. We make that's very, very important to us. And we realize when you say you're a Christian company, you have an obligation to act like one. So we try our best to act like one. Our in the company, we tell all the people that work there that the priorities are your God's first, family second, and then maybe a company can come in. But those two, you can't have a good company without having the Lord in first place and your family up there first, and then you can do your work well. So that's what we try to do. We've always done that through our 45-year history. We started 45 years ago, and at that time, I was working for a small company, and that company went broke. So I was looking for a job, and I went to my wife, and I said, we've got a problem here. We've got some bad news. I'm being fired from the company, and that's not a good word to use, but I mean let go, whatever you want to say. We're not going to have an income from the company, so why don't we start our own company? So she said, that's a good idea. Let's do it. So just without any hesitation whatsoever, we grew up and we like to tell poor stories, and I bet, Red, you could tell a few poor stories, but we had a few poor stories, and Paula didn't have the security of having known that you could always have a paycheck. Now she was going to wonder what's going to happen, but she accepted it 100%. Started out as an engineer. I'm an engineer, got a master's degree from Oklahoma University. And in starting out, I worked with a geologist, Bob Leininger, who's also with the company that folded. And so we started the company. We had, Paul and I had two kids, one-year-old and three-year-old, two girls, and then we had a mortgage on our house, and we had no savings. So you can literally say we started out with zero. So if you try to figure out the percentage growth of zero, it's pretty high. So we grew the company pretty fast, actually not too fast. It took us 7 years to make our first $1 million. But the Bible says income or riches grown slowly will be grown successfully. So if you can grow it slowly and build it slowly, that's what we've done. We haven't done anything spectacular, except towards the end of my career, and I'll tell you about that in a little bit. But we had a plan, and that's one of the things I recommend for all entrepreneurs, is you have a plan. And our plan was really simple. First, we'd become consultants. Then we'd become operators in that we operated drilling wells, and then we'd operate the pumping units and the tank batteries and everything after that. Then we'd become an oil company where we actually owned a lot of the working interest. We started out owning about 5%. Well, as a consultant, we started out and we never missed a payday. We paid ourselves the same salary we made working for this small company. So that was quite an achievement in those days. So we figured that we turned a bad news of getting fired into good news of being successful. But then we had to try to get the next step, which is becoming an operator. And 1 year into our program, we got the big break, and Tesoro told us that they would let us become operators. So we stopped all our other consulting work. We just went and worked for the Tesoro group, right around Christmas time, and it seems like it always happens around Christmas time, we got more bad news. They decided not to fund our program. So where are we going to get our money to operate off of now since we stopped doing consulting work? So we started back the consulting group again and slowly built our way back into it. Never borrowed any money, except later on when we had something to borrow against. So a year later, Hanover Planning came into our group, and this time they said that they would fund our operations. And what we were going to do is to operate, we'll turnkey a well and turnkey the well to the casing point. That's to the drilling contractor sets casing. And we'd make $6,000 off the turnkey. Now, the reason why a company that had no assets at all could do this is we were having the drilling contractor turnkey to us. So we had no risk in it whatsoever. And so, and we'd make $6,000. While we were consultants, we did a job on Spraberry Field, which is the largest field out in West Texas, and the largest field in the nation, and the largest field in the world in terms of number of oil wells. Mm-hmm. So we did a job on that oil on the Spraberry Formation, and we became known as experts on the Spraberry Formation, and. For that job, which took several months, we got $6,000. The same amount of money that we're going to make for drilling a well, which took us 2 or 3 days of work to do. So I didn't understand how you could make money so easily. But that was great. We Hanover, their money fell through, like the other company, like Tesoro did. But they turned it to someone else that did have the money. So we... we're able to start in on our 663 program, which resulted us in getting started as operators. Now let's fast forward about 30 years. I'm still concentrating on the Spraberry. We got a farm out on the Spraberry in in Midland County, just south of Midland, and we drilled some Spraberry wells and included the formation below the Spraberry, the Wolf Camp. Now, our predecessor in this was Arco, and they had drilled about 300 wells in the Spraberry and the Wolf Camp, and they had taken the George Mitchell frack technique and fracked these wells, and they weren't very economical. But as they went forward, they after 300 wells, they got pretty good at it. Then we took it over, and we tweaked it some, and we came up with a way of making these wells economic, and it started the Wolfberry boom in Texas now. And if you ever come to Midland, you'll see all these rigs drilling around there, and they're drilling in the Wolfberry. So we started the Wolfberry boom. We drilled one well close to where Arco had been drilling. Then we moved 20 miles south, drilled another well, and that well came in great too. Both wells came in great. So we knew we discovered a field that was at least 20 miles long, which is unheard of in any place. So we made the biggest discovery in West Texas in the last 50 years. Now thousands of wells have been drilled. Thousands of wells have been drilled. So after drilling them, we then bought a lot of acreage. We bought about 300,000 acres out there. And then we turned everything in about July of 2008 to Concho. Made a lot of money off of that. We decided we did not want to be a big company, and 100 people were a big company for us. So we sold out to Concho. And then we rebuilt the company, and 2 years later we sold out to Lynn. And so between those two sales then, we had already given half the company to our kids, our three kids, and we set up a foundation to give the other half to. So then we're now now trying to get back in the game, and we're finally trying to get more acreage out there, and it's very difficult to do so. One of the things everybody asks me is, what do you think the future is going to be like? Especially out there in the Midland, Texas area. And my take on the future is it's extremely bright. It really looks good, especially for those that have the hard rocks like we do in West Texas. Because when you drill this George Mitchell well, where you go down and you drill horizontal well and you frack the whole thing with 20 some odd stages, a tremendous amount of water and sand. And when you do that, you get 6% of the oil in place, leaving behind 94% of the oil. And I think technology will find a way to get a large part of that oil out. That's why I say the future is bright. There's a tremendous amount of oil down there. Now we're doing horizontal drilling, and actually what we're doing is we're mining oil and gas. And that's where we, instead of drilling for it, we're mining it, because it's down there. We just have to figure out how to get it out. So that's what the future is. Got several lessons that I learned.
Yeah, that's great. Great. Okay. And do tell us, where along the way did you start to get interested in some of the ideas that TPPF cares so much about?
Yes. Okay, let me tell you your ideas.
Yeah, okay.
First, then
great.
I'll tell you about that. When you go start something, have a plan. Our plan covered less than half a sheet of paper. But we had the plan, and we worked the plan, and it really helped. Two, when you have bad times, turn that into good times. That's not hard to do. You got to be positive. We concentrated on the Spraberry. For the last 45 years, we worked in the Spraberry. And it helps to know the area you're working in, and we have a tremendous amount of experience in it. We know it, and that's how we're able to bring the George Mitchell frack technique into there. And also, people say, since we're able to accumulate some wealth, they said that you were really lucky, and they're right. I was lucky, but I like to say the harder you work, the luckier you get. So, The George Mitchell has done so much for the oil industry. But we are taking what he has done and improving on it almost on a daily basis. Mm. You're seeing oil technology improve rapidly. And they say solar and wind is improving. We're improving faster. Mm. And we're able to get oil out. If you give us $70 oil, we can do it economically. Mm. It can be done. So don't bet against technology. And I also, one of the things we have in the motto in our company is only those that are doing things are making mistakes. Hmm. So if you're doing nothing, you're going to sit around and do things. But if you're making mistakes, just don't make that same mistake too much, please. So because some mistakes can cost us $1 million or more. So, but how did I get interested? You say, Evan?
Sure. Just real quick, what was your first interest there?
I was... Since I turned the business over many years ago to other people to do all the work, I had some free time, so I spent my time working in nonprofits in Midland, Texas. And one of the nonprofits I worked for was the Permian Basin Petroleum Association. And Permian Basin Petroleum Association is the technology, I mean, is the business association or the political association of West Texas, and it's in Midland, Texas. So I was president at that time, and I noticed that of all of our membership, which was several hundred, only about 10% really contributed time and money to the company and to that nonprofit institute. And I said, do I want to be the 90% that tag along and don't do anything? Or do I want to be the 10% in the forefront that make a difference? I noticed in Austin that money makes a difference. You talk about one person, one vote. I don't mean to deride Austin, but it's more like $1, one vote. So money will make a difference. So we've got Rick to help us with this, with it, to help us work with, and we noticed with, I think TPPF is on the forefront, is a spear edge, and is a fighting arm of our industry, and they can get out there and get things done. That's why I want to go with TPPF.
Yeah.
And I want to get things done politically. I gave a speech the other day, and I said that you don't have to worry about the oil. The oil is there. What you have to worry about is EPA, the endangered species, the government things. That's much more threatening to your our industry than lack of technology.
Good word. Well, Red, I want to put you on the spot here if I could. I'm new to this state, as I mentioned earlier, and there's some conversation here today about building a business in Texas. So I'd love you to give me some advice about being a new person in Texas. What does it take to do business well in Texas? Is there such a thing as a Texas way of business?
Well, I don't know that you'd say that, but I think that Texas has done a good job of continuing to understand that these regulations are all damaging. None of them really show any real promise for upward involvement for anybody. So I think that with the tort reform and with the other things that I've seen happen over the last 40 years, that we're better positioned than others are. And just think in time what opportunities we're going to have to the north in Canada, into the south, particularly in Mexico, Central America, and South America, because I think the best is yet to come. But we have to take the leadership, show the way, and lead to the harvest. So I'm very optimistic about if you're going to be in the field, Texas is the best place to be. If you don't care to participate, well, then that's another story.
You made two comments about your own worldview about how you approach business, which I love, resonated with me. One was you never did it for the money, and number two was that you expected to win. Is it fair to say, are those Texas virtues of business?
Well, yeah, I don't know. I think back of I love reading the history of anybody at any time, and if you look back to the people that came to Texas and what they're looking for was freedom and opportunity. I think that's still what we have here, and I think we do a better job of it than elsewhere. So until some of these other states wake up before they get drowned, which most of them are going to get drowned, then it just looks better for Texas. We take the leadership. We get some of these crazy regulations off to where we can move product out of Canada, and not only to Texas, but around the world. And then if we can take advantage of the harvest that's awaiting us in Mexico and Central and South America, where they need technology and they got plenty of labor, it looks to me as if it's just going to be a great time to be involved in that. I know at the business school here, and I'm sure it's similar elsewhere, In the last 3 years, our graduates out of the business school on both the baccalaureate side and on the master's side all got signing bonuses as well as a job, and starting pay for most of the people after signing bonuses in the baccalaureate side was from $50,000 to $60,000 and up to $55,000 to $70,000 for the master's degree people. Very good starting opportunities. Everyone that used the employment service at the university, which of course is there for the students, and it cost them nothing. Everyone that used that, that wanted a job, got a job. So we're doing well. We're fighting the bureaucrats within the UT system to allow crossover degrees to where we can take people in engineering and liberal arts and in other areas where we can take them and give them 4 basic business courses, and then they allow our students to go over and get 4 courses over theirs. And that if we can do that in a year, then we in 5 years we'll get master's degree type finishers, and instead of 1 degree, we get the 2 degrees and get it done in 5 years. But there is bureaucracy that you find everywhere, every day. It's kind of like the devil, he never sleeps. You just have to gear up and go get it done. But it is there. And I think that, now we operate out of Texas. We operate in about 15 states. But we are the best shot in Texas. You got a better chance of keeping more of your money and getting the money in the first place in Texas, I think, than you do any place in the United States. On medicine, on this crazy thing that we're facing here in this medicine thing, which was alluded to today at lunch, we're all going to have to wade through that. It's going to be costly to all of us. But the sooner we can get away from it, the better. And there are people working day and night to get us away from it. And that's what we have to do. When I ended up United Way in San Antonio and the people wanted to write the program, like, what are we saying, what are we trying to accomplish and all? And I said, well, we really don't need any time on that because it's pretty simple. We want when the sun sets every night in San Antonio that nobody goes to bed hungry, regardless. It just doesn't happen. We want in San Antonio, if anyone wants a job but doesn't have one, then we got to see that we can help them find one. And if we do that, then we get over to the medicine side. And they say, well, they got no insurance or whatever such. Okay, so you may have to wait a little longer before you may not get the doctor you want, but we don't want anyone who needs medical service but can't afford it, that doesn't get it just because they can't afford it. And pretty simple, just pretty simple programs that we try to do, and I think Texas is full of that. We just have to stay the course and not take the easy way out, which sometimes looks like the best way, but it never is, ever, the best way. I've been an athletic team owner for 32 years of my adult life. And every time you see a guy that's trying to get from A to Z and cut the way he gets there, he may get lucky a time or two, but you know he's not going to make it, because in the long run it won't work. You have to pay the price, you get there. So long answer to your question, I'm sorry for taking so much time, but that's what I kind of see that we're facing. I don't think there's ever been a better time in the history of Texas for young people than there is right today. I think this is the best time. And that's why I'm trying to do my workouts each day and see if I can crowd that time and get a little more time. Because at the end, you know, somebody says, well, what would you want more than anything else in the world? Well, I'll tell you what I want is one more day.
Red, would you, round of applause. Well, you know, Dr. Jim and Jim, I want to ask you guys both about at least my experience has been when we first set out to defend some what seemed to be some general tenets of limited government or free market, or in your case, your own personal Christian faith, we set out, I did, a little bit naively about, well, of course people would respect my ability to defend those positions. And often in the media and even people we work with, it ends up not quite going that well. Dr. Jim, I believe at one point you were called the most dangerous man in Texas. Tell us about being on the front lines. You set out to do just something you thought seemed pretty basic, but everybody hates you now.
Well, happened after a particular disappointing vote in the Texas State House of Representatives, where we lost by one vote. And actually, the speaker came down off the dais, and it wasn't going the way he had expected, so he kind of put a hold on it and lobbied just enough people that we lost by one vote. So I decided there was five Republicans that just needed to be replaced. And I had no, yeah, there have been more since. I don't know if I was the first one that ever did that or what, but I mean, there was this firestorm of criticism of, you know, how could you run against the incumbent Republican? And, you know, I just simply said, well, if they're not going to help the children, then I'm going to run against them in any way and every way I can. And, well, there was a lot of other little epithets, but the one I remember the most was that because I was helping five non-incumbents, I was the most dangerous man in Texas.
And how did you handle that? I mean, did you have moments of, you know, you hear stories about a friend at the country club not looking you in the face, or someone at church, or a neighbor sort of never knew you were such an evil capitalist or evil free government defender? Anything personal happen?
You know, it was just the opposite. When it was obvious I was going to be criticized in the media, because I certainly wasn't politically correct, I sat down with my wife and we talked about it and said, you know, it might be hurtful or harmful or upsetting sometimes, but, you know, I think, you know, just like Davy Crockett said, be sure you're right and then go ahead. And, you know, I said, I'm sure this is the right thing. And, you know, he didn't say, go ahead and do a poll or go ahead and do a study. He said, let's go to the Alamo and fight those guys. So that's what I concluded. Cecilia was very supportive. And I sat my little kids down. They were, you know, 10, 11, 12 at the time. But I explained to them that, you know, they might see something on the television or something on the newspaper that, I mean, I was a recluse, and then I was a wild-eyed religious nut, and, you know, I mean, I just ignored all those things because I concluded there wasn't anything I could do about it. I mean, if you call them up and try to correct all the errors in the last story, then they just use that to validate their next incorrect story. Mm. So I just quit talking to them, and they just really didn't like that. You know, they wanted a response out of me, and they wanted some kind of, controversy that they could write about. So I just kept doing that since they didn't like it. And my opinion was that I had no way to control or stop or even modify what they were saying. And anybody that I knew would know none of that stuff was true, so I just didn't worry about it. Mm. And I think the thing that helped the most really was just the, you know, we had faith in God, and I was sure that we were doing the right thing. You know, I mean, there were some times I opposed people who I wish I hadn't, or that sort of thing. And only because, I mean, people who are really good legislators or really good individuals, but they voted wrong on school choice. And so, you know, I backed the other candidate who was really a dud. Mm. And so, you know, you always have, you know, you make mistakes, especially if you're a political novice like I was. But at the same time, we, you know, as long as you keep your eye on the higher purpose and not on the, you know, you don't get in the political gutter and I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that you don't want to be part of. But, you know, we just relied on the Lord to sustain us, you know, when it was hard, and just kept doing what we thought was right.
I want to make a comment, if I might, on another thing that Dr. Jim said that I think we all have to, we got to really think about. We did get a break yesterday and get a little closer to school choice. Now, this idea of letting politics get in the way of letting the most precious asset we have, which is our children, we cannot allow that. We just can't allow it. And those of us even that say don't have kids in school now, we've got to be active and give these kids a chance. We owe it to them. They didn't ask to be born. And if their parents are not going to do it for them, we have to do it for them. But we've got to get that choice in. Choice is not the answer to everything in the world, but it is a much better solution than anything that we have out there now. It's very simple. Choice is just that. And most people are going to take the right choice. We know that these kids are bright. We see the toys that they've got, which none of us can even work anymore. And they're bright. They know what to do with them. And you give them a chance. All this stuff about we don't have it is all wrong. I've proven for myself, without going into personal anecdotes, that these kids are bright. And at risk school, you can take 4 years and bring it right back to the top. And give the teachers a chance. And those who want to. And those that don't want to work or want to teach, move them on down the road. But we cannot let the unions control what happens in our schools. And we got people, like Jim says, that are really good people in every sense in the world, but they're in that union mode when it comes to teaching school. Well, we can't have it. You know, it's very simple. You've got to move them out of the way. And if you do move them out of the way, these kids will get it. They will all get it. Mm. And now we got real good, solid movements going all over the state, and hopefully in other states, to where we've always known high school kids are absolutely capable of doing much more than what most of them do. So we get them in and start early on the first year in high school and get them through enough courses to get two years of the basics of the college that they go to. They've got a much better, got a head start, they're ready for it, they do better work, and they can and will do better work. And we prove it time and time again, but we've got to get this choice, we've got to get it done. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got a better chance now than we ever had.
Well, Jim, this is the last question to you, and then we'll turn it over to Q&A, so do have some questions ready. I admire how you talked about building a Christian business and encouraging your employees to have the right ordering of priorities in their life. And I think there are a lot of analogies to those of us out trying to defend liberty that Leslie Newbegin has a great book, and the title is really illustrative. He talks about the gospel as being foolishness to the Greeks. Yeah. And I think in a lot of ways, limited government and free market is foolishness to the liberals. Yeah, right. And so curious if you just share a little bit about how you talk about your faith, knowing that to some people it is controversial. How are you winsome about how you do that, such that we might learn how to be better communicators of the things that we believe in?
That's a good, can you hear me? Am I? Okay, I think that's a good question. You can appeal to him in one way. I think it's in Ukraine now. They're trying to promote Christianity, the government is, because they find the Christians are more reliable than the non-Christians. Hmm. They have better work ethics. The Christian work ethic is what got this country started. So that's one way you can talk to them about Christianity and is through the fact that these laws and Proverbs and in the Bible are real. And if you go by them and you abide by them, you'll live a better life. So that's the way I talked. I just got through talking to my grandson yesterday about this.
Mm. How old is he?
He's, how old is he, 16?
16.
And and 16. How'd it go? How did he go?
Well, he's always, he and I love each other. And so he's always listens to me. Whether he'll do anything, I don't know.
And so what, I mean, when you see young people out there who have a deep faith or a deep politics, I mean, what's your counsel to them, to us, to be more effective for these things we believe in?
Well, I have a niece that's now in Colorado, going to Colorado State, is that, I think it is, in Fort Collins. And she's in the heart of all of the liberal, and I would love to counsel her and say, keep your Christian faith. Don't let them talk you out of it, because the green side, the left side, is most of them are non-Christians. They can't think the way they do, and put they believe in population control, which means that it's fine to let people starve to death, and that's not the Christian way of doing it. So I try to tell my niece, don't lose your Christian principles in this ultra green atmosphere out here in Colorado.
Yeah. Well, good word. Well, thank you, Jim. Well, now we're going to turn it over to some question and answer. Just as a reminder, we ask you to express a question, not a statement, to do it in one breath. And if you could, try to address a specific person so that we can kind of dive right in and run through a few. We've got some mics on the floor, so maybe hands up for questions. Let's see, we've got one right here in the back. And if you would, speak into the mic so that the folks upstairs can hear it too.
Okay, for Jim Henry, continuing on the theme of building your business on Christian principles, could you discuss what role tithing played for you?
Yes, I've always believed in tithing. I think it's harder for people just starting out to tithe. We've given 50% of our wealth to foundations that's dedicated on Christian principles and to helping people, primarily in Midland, Texas. So I think that's one of the rules. And if you'll follow that rule very carefully, you'll be blessed. And the Lord says he'll bless you and return more than anything you can imagine. And he has blessed us, Paul and me, and our family. He has blessed us tremendously. It's amazing how that works. It really works. So I think tithing is extremely important.
It's good. Next up, hands up.
They've had enough.
Yeah, sure. Mike's coming on over.
This is for Jim Leininger. And tell me about the influence that your wife has had in all of this that you've accomplished over the years.
Well, I can tell you that maybe it's my medical background, but she thinks that entrepreneurship is a disease. And, and she doesn't understand why I do things that I do or think the way I do a lot of times. But I have to say that, you know, there was a point in the last Saturday of April in 1979 where I was just done. You know, I tried everything I knew. The company was bankrupt. The only guy in the company with any business experience was an attorney and an accountant, and he had resigned that day. And I think we were down to 8 or 9 employees, and it was really hopeless. And it occurred to me that, you know, I had counseled quite a number of people in my medical practice, and I knew that the number one cause of divorce was financial problems, at least at that time. And so it occurred to me, maybe I better check in with Cecilia and see if she was okay with me. And so I sat her down and explained how bad it was, basically. And she listened, and we had just moved into a new house, and I explained that we'd have to sell that house and move back into the one-bedroom apartment. And of course, we had three kids by this time, and that didn't sound too good. But I laid it out there as plainly as I could, and I said, I just need to know if you want to still be with me. And I honestly didn't know what she was going to say. We weren't having any troubles that I, in particular, but I didn't think this is what she'd signed up for. And so she told me that as long as I still loved her, she didn't care if we lived in a tent. And boy, that really buoyed my hope and my faith and my determination to keep at it. And literally that same afternoon, we just went up to the bedroom and got down on our knees, and we started praying. And I just said, Lord, you know, I thought this was what you wanted me to do, but I've obviously messed this up something terrible. And I don't know what to do. I'm exhausted. I've been working 24-hour shifts in the emergency room, and then going over and working, you know, until 7, 8 at night at the company, and then go home and go to bed, and then do another 36. And I did that for almost 3 years. And I was totally exhausted. I mean, I just, you know, I mean, you get to the point where you can't even think straight. And so I said, Lord, I'm done. I am done. I don't have more ideas. I don't have any more energy. I'm exhausted. If you want to make something out of this company, then you do it, because I'm done. And I meant it. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, Lord, bail me out. I was spent. I had nothing, no reserve left. And I could write a book on the next 60 days, but I can tell you that in 60 days, we had sold every hospital bed that we could manufacture the rest of the year, and we were completely out of debt. And So the Lord does a good job. And I think, you know, I had been raised in a Christian home, but I went to college and medical school, and I thought I was really hot stuff. And I decided, I didn't really understand all this evolution stuff, so I decided I was an agnostic. And that way, you know, it was kind of convenient, because I believed in God, but he was just up there somewhere making universes or whatever God did. And I, you know, there was no accountability, you know, because as I would say at that time, he doesn't care what color tie I wear today. And that day when we got down on our knees changed everything for me, changed my life completely. And I know that it's real now. You know, it's not for so many things in so many ways. It's a walk of faith, and it's something we don't know or we can't see. But since that time, I've had a relationship with the Lord that I don't know why he's blessed me so much with this, but I know that it's real, and that he loves me, and that he cares about me. And frankly, looking back, I was so obnoxious that I don't know why in the world, if I'd have been God, I'd have hit that guy with a lightning bolt. So anyway, he has love and mercy for us that is beyond anything we could imagine or we could ever have.
Mm. That's the same kind of faith Travis had when he drew that line.
Yeah. Mm. Well, I think we have time for one more question. Any other hands out there? Yeah, right there, great.
Excuse me, sir. All three of you touched on hard work, education, success. to all three of you, or Mr. McCombs in particular, since you have been asked in particular, could you tell us about making opportunity for yourself and taking advantage of that?
I believe so. Kind of how to make opportunity for yourself and take advantage of it. If you kind of seem like you're given a bad lot, maybe you, how do you go out and create an opportunity for yourself?
Let me do that. I'll do this real quick because it's one of my pet peeves. I have two pet peeves about business. One is, these are sayings that everybody knows. Opportunity knocks but once. That is pure baloney. I mean, in our society today, opportunity is knocking every week. You have to be careful to choose the right opportunity because, what I prefer to say, opportunities like buses. If you miss one, there'll be another one come along pretty soon. So that is a key element. There are so many opportunities. Stick with what you know. Take opportunities in the area and the field of your expertise. Because I've sure lost a lot of money in things, trying to get another education in a whole new business or science that I didn't know anything about, only to figure out that I should have stayed with medicine that I did know a little bit about. And the second one is, if you build a better mousetrap, the world will beat a path to your door. That is baloney. If you don't have a better mousetrap, don't even bother. And if you do have a better mousetrap, you better market it like crazy. You better market better than anybody else in the world, because there are going to be 40 other guys that have a mousetrap just like yours in about a year or two. So, marketing in any business setting is the most important thing. And be very careful with opportunities, because there's a lot of them, and a lot of them look really good. And if you're motivated like I am to heal every disease of mankind, they're not all going to work, I can tell you. And so just choose your opportunities carefully.
Well, the other thing I'd like to comment on is there's no one that escapes problems. There are problems. You're going to have problems. But don't get yourself in a point to where you think, as Jim says, to where there's just no way out. And give up on what you're doing. But while you're doing what you're doing, be looking to see if there's not a better shot over here somewhere. But the worst place you can get into is to get out of the play altogether and then not have anything to do. I mean, that's the worst thing that could happen to anybody. Because what I tell students all the time is, I so like what I'm doing. Well, work harder at it. Somebody will see you. And they'll notice you. Offer to do a little more. Come early, stay late. You got to get attention. But don't walk off. The hardest time in the world to get a job is when you're out of a job. And then when you get a job, if it's not exactly what you think heaven meant for you, do it the best you can and somebody to get you out of there. I've never seen a business in my mind, this is just my mind, I'm not seeing anybody else would look at it this way, but I think I can operate any business better than the people who are running. And I don't care what, really. So as long as you feel good about what you're doing and what you can do, but you can't give up what you got over here, because that's the worst thing you do, get out on an island there where you're by yourself. You got to be in the play. Coach doesn't call your play, will slip in.
You want a final word?
Yeah. Opportunity, our company is a conservative company. We're careful what we do. We like to look at opportunity in a baseball analogy, singles, doubles, and home runs. We like to swing for singles or doubles. But if you give us a fat one across the place, we'll knock it out of the park. Which we did on the Wolfberry. That's all.
Well, Dr. Jim, I know we all appreciate your work in eradicating illnesses and disease. A disease I am thankful you are not successful in fighting is the disease of entrepreneurship. The three of you have it just a horrible way, but we are thankful that you do have it. We are thankful as part of TPPF, as Texans, and the United States is thankful for the businesses and the generosity that you guys have shown. So thank you personally.
Well, we want to be thankful to Dr. Jim for getting this program off the ground when it was not moving so fast. Stayed the course. It encouraged a lot of us. We got to do the same thing and stay in there. Now, of course, we got a great platform here, and all we have to do is continue to support it and expand it, period. And if you want to keep a little more money in the bank, do not go to visit Wendy Graham. I can tell you, she can undress you with your eyes open.
Well, to Dr. Jim for part of the intellectual and ideological inspiration, and to Wendy for the shakedowns that enable this to happen. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you all. You know, the interesting thing, they're talking about business, but it strikes me that in my world, in our world, Wendy, we're always hiring the best policy entrepreneurs we can find. So while this is absolutely imperative to the future of Texas and free enterprise, it's also very applicable to the work that we do every day, because all of our great staffers who are here, when we talk to them, are you a policy entrepreneur? Can you go out and take these ideas and this hard work and look for opportunity to change the world? So I am so grateful to all of you for being here, and thank you all for joining us, and especially to three of the greatest businessmen of our generation or any generation this state has ever seen. Please help me thank them one more time. And thank you, Evan. Thank you.
Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thank
Appreciate
you so much.
Evan.
And just loved hearing about your business, and
good.
So inspired.
I didn't
you know.
Bore you to death.
Oh, no, not at all.